Hello, this is Vivica Williams, and you're watching Head to Head. On July 9th, European and Ukrainian leaders met in Brussels for the annual EU-Ukraine summit, the 20th of its kind. Topics discussed included not only the association agreement, but also the Minsk Agreements and Ukraine's reform agenda. Even though this is the 20th summit, many of the things being spoken about European leaders were being heard for the first time. So to talk more about the outcomes of the summit, we're joined in the studio today by Leonid Litra. He's a senior research fellow at the New Europe Center. Thank you so much for being with us today, Leonid.
Thank you for inviting.
So as we said, the meeting now is not so much completely about the association agreement. This was the original aim of these EU-Ukraine summits, but now it's really evolved into something more.
Well, indeed, EU-Ukraine summit started a long time ago, and when the association agreement was not there yet. These days, or today, the last summit, association agreement was one of the central elements of the summit, although we had this time many other issues which have not been before part of the EU-Ukraine summit. So, the EU, the joint statement after the summit recognizes the European aspirations of Ukraine, which is a very strong political signal. I mean, this is one of the reasons, precisely one of the reasons why last year Ukraine and European Union was not able to agree on a joint statement. So, so they managed to come up, and Ukraine position was basically reflected in the joint declaration.
So, for example, so last year, Europe wasn't comfortable with including that European...
Yes, there were several countries blocked the statement at that time, precisely for referring to the European aspiration of Ukraine. Although I don't think it was a big issue because, I mean, the association agreement itself has a footnote. I mean, let's put like this in the preamble. It has a reference to the European aspirations, but for some domestic political reasons, some of the European countries prefer not to have this in the joint statement. This time we have this, and we also have this. The issue of Russia being called an aggressor in the joint statement, which again is a very strong political signal, and it describes precisely the role of Russia in annexing Ukraine and in basically supporting and escalating the war in the east of Ukraine. So basically, this is an achievement because Russia used to play the mediator in Ukraine and trying to pretend that what's going on in Ukraine is actually an internal conflict.
Right, they were already pushing that it was a civil war.
And precisely.
And so what do you think this means? What does this signal? Because this has been an issue that we look at worldwide. Okay, we label, you know, Ukraine, Russia is labeled the aggressor, is recognized for this type of aggression that they've done, the downing of MH17, this call for them to take responsibility, this declaration about the release of political prisoners. So where does it go from there? Will this translate into more concrete actions or more damning statements from the EU?
Well, I think that the very fact that EU agreed to, I mean, to include these terms in its official narrative, in its official messaging, it's a very big step forward. But I assume that knowing EU is a very consistent player. I mean, I assume that in the future EU is going to put pressure, diplomatic pressure, on Russia in delivering on things which were mentioned in the summit. So putting pressure on releasing the political prisoners, the Ukrainian citizens, which are currently detained illegally in Russia, or in taking the responsibility for the downing of MH17. So I think these are some of the issues, but widely speaking, I mean, Ukraine EU summit was not focused only on Russia. Certainly Russia was one of the issues, but there have been so much discussions about trade, about anti-corruption court and about a series of reforms which are taking place currently in Ukraine, actually.
So let's talk about some of the issues they brought up. So let's start with the issue of trade, and specifically increases in trade. Now, we have a soundbite.
Trade go up by almost 25% last year, which is not nothing. And the number of Ukrainian companies exported to the European Union is always up by over 40%, going from 10,000 to 14,136, which is an encouraging result and which is helping Ukraine to grow on a steady pace.
Well, can you give us a little insight then based, you know, he talks about this increase in trade, this 40%. So what's what are some of the implications of what they discussed about trade in this?
Well, basically, the big idea out of the statement of Mr. Juncker is that what we can conclude is that the association agreement works. That's actually, it's because the trade does not increase from nothing. I mean, there's been the association agreement, which entered fully into force since September last year. And now there is the basically the creation of the proper conditions for businesses on both, I mean, sides in Ukraine and the European Union to basically develop trade deals and business. So what President of European Commission mentioned is that the trade increased. And if we look a little bit into statistics, we will see that it's not only raw materials as it used to be before, mm-hmm. but it's also actually a lot of basically products which Ukraine is selling, and services, which is also something new. So I think that this is a clear demonstration that the association agreement started to be implemented.
And we also see in the domestic, because you know, we talk here about what Europe has seen, the benefits Europe has had in this 40% trade. And what are we seeing in Europe? We also have a lot of great signs that the association agreement is working and helping on the behalf of Ukrainians when it comes to the prices, perhaps, of some goods and services that are imported from the EU?
Well, I mean, trade is not my biggest area of expertise since I'm covering political issues more, but I think the fact that there is an increase in trade, and with the association agreement, a lot of products started to be imported by Ukraine at lower prices because the association agreement allows for this, provides for this, and we also have quotas. I mean, on which Ukraine exports a lot of things without paying taxes. Actually, I mean, in the European Union, and therefore makes its products more affordable in the EU and more competitive on the market.
Oh, this is a great thing. And let's talk then about a little bit about energy security. So this was also one of the major issues that they brought up.
Well, there are several, I mean, dimensions of this issue, I would say. One is it has to do with domestic reforms in Ukraine. So this is the electricity market. This is unbundling of Naftogaz. This is basically the implementation of the third package, of the third energy package in Ukraine. But there is also a different dimension of the energy security question, and that relates precisely to the Nord Stream 2 project, which is a project of Gazprom, and it basically it's a political project aimed to take off transit road from Ukraine, basically.
Right.
That's
not
the idea behind. And Ukraine wanted the EU, of course, to raise this issue at the EU level.
But there's a lot of kind of even conflict within the EU over this. I mean, Germany definitely benefits from this plan. So.
Well, Germany benefits, and basically at this moment there is no EU legislation. Well, not EU legislation, there is no national legislation that would basically make impossible this project. Therefore, if there would be enough political will at the EU level to submit basically this project under the EU legislation, that would be a step forward, because then the member states will be given the chance to influence the fate of the project.
Because it doesn't even fit, it failed meeting the third package issues of Europe, which was the unbundling of supply and delivery. Yeah. So, and it still doesn't seem to meet these.
Ukraine.
The Nord Stream.
Nord Stream. Yeah, but it's because EU treats Nord Stream as a project which is not under the EU legislation, which is out of the EU legislation. And if the project would become part of the, basically, would be under the EU legislation, then all these issues, as you mentioned, just the third package would be applied to the Nord Stream 2, and then Russia would have a big headache, and I don't think they would go ahead with this project anymore. So Ukraine is precisely willing to get this project under the EU legislation, so that the project will have to be in line with all the EU regulations and requirements, and then the member states will have the chance to influence basically the project. And there's quite a few member states actually in the EU who are not happy with the fact that Nord Stream is ongoing.
Absolutely. And then just the last question, let's talk a bit about some of the agreements that came out of this. So, for example, there's the small agreement of the 75 million euros being given to Ukraine for projects on road safety and road improvements. Yeah. And this is one of the maybe the smaller things that came out of that. What other agreements or financing issues were resolved or discussed?
Well, indeed, this is one of the project which was agreed there. It has to do with the road safety and the improvement of the road infrastructure, basically. However, I would mention the 1 billion macro financial program. So this is the fourth macro financial program of EU in Ukraine.
Were they able? Now, this was something agreed upon, and I think on the 7th, the third day after it was published in the EU Observer, kind of implemented. So in this EU summit, they discussed more about the requirements for receiving the 1 billion?
Yes, because basically the process was finished within the EU. It means they received all the OKs, they checked all the boxes in terms of procedure in the EU. However, in order that Ukraine would be able to access the funds which are offered by the EU, Ukraine has to agree, first of all, on the set of conditions together with the Union, the European Union. This would be signed in a memorandum between Ukrainian government and the European Commission. And then once Ukraine delivers on its commitments which were taken within the memorandum, then it will be first tranche issued, first installment, and then second. I mean, I heard some very optimistic ideas that Ukraine might get first installment in September. Mm-hmm. I think this is a little
bit too optimistic.
However, I think that by the end of the year is doable if Ukraine is going to prioritize, the reforms which are going to be part of the agreement.
And is this kind of a timely, offering of these loans when we look at next year, 2019, being an election year?
Well, absolutely, because, I mean, Ukraine is lacking cheap funds, basically, yeah? Cheap money, and this loan is basically a loan which has a very low interest rate. It's actually 0.02. It's nothing, I mean. Right. And Ukraine needs this money because it's not only related with the elections. Sure,
it requires some honoring and looking at democratic measures and policies for...
Absolutely, absolutely. This is a way to mobilize, actually, the Ukrainian political elite and the Ukrainian government to stay focused on reforms and, basically be in line with the spirit of the agreements between Ukraine and the EU. So this is very important to keep it high standards before the elections and during the elections.
Thank you so much for being with us today, Leonid, and giving us some insight in the outcomes and what we can hopefully look to see in the afterwards, what's going to develop, what works and what maybe doesn't work so well. And that was Leonid Litra. He's a senior research fellow at the New Europe Center. Thank you for watching and stay tuned to UATV.